found in the Apostle Peter's first general epistle, chapter 5, verse 8. Be self-controlled and alert, because your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking for someone to devour. If you read English literary works, you will come across Humpty Dumpty. In medieval England, Humpty Dumpty originated as a puzzle or a riddle. Then in the 18th century, it was transformed into a nursery rhyme. It goes like this. Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men could not put Humpty back together again. Now, who was Humpty Dumpty? There are several theories about his identity. Shakespeare, for example, believed that Humpty Dumpty referred to King Richard III, who was humpbacked or hunchbacked and was killed in battle in the year 1485. Actually, his enemies hacked his body into pieces. Shakespeare wrote a play entitled Richard III, and there he says that Humpty Dumpty referred to Richard III, whose body was hacked into pieces and nobody could put him back together again. But there are other views. In the year 1648, a civil war broke out in England between the royalists and the parliamentarians. The leader of the royalists was, of course, King Charles I, who believed in the divine rights of king. He believed in the divine rights of kings, which meant that he believed God had chosen the kings and all citizens must obey their king the way they obeyed God. The leader of the parliamentarians was Oliver Cromwell, who believed that the monarch should not rule without the consent of Parliament. So the two sides could not agree, and a civil war broke out in England in the year 1648. The fiercest battles of that civil war was fought in the city of Colchester. In 1996, the website of the city of Colchester attributed the origin of the Humpty Dumpty rhyme to a cannon that was placed by the royalists on a wall of the city castle. And during the battle, that royalist cannon, which was called Humpty Dumpty, was hit by a shell fired by the parliamentarians, and the cannon fell off the wall and was damaged beyond repair. And so the citizens of the British city of Colchester believe that Humpty Dumpty was a cannon. Lewis Carroll, a great British literary figure who is best known for being the author of Alice in Wonderland, I'm sure you all read Alice in Wonderland when you were children. Now, he says Humpty Dumpty was an egg that was placed on a wall and then it fell off and was shattered. And nobody could put it back together again. Now, whether Humpty Dumpty was King Richard III or a cannon or an egg, it makes no difference. All those references tell us that Humpty Dumpty was shattered, broken into pieces, and could not be restored. That's the main idea. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, verses 26 through 38, we meet another Humpty Dumpty. Jesus and his disciples went by boat to the region of the Gerasenes. Now, this region is on the east side of the Jordan River, about 6 miles southeast of the Sea of Galilee. This region, the region of the Gerasenes, had a mixed population. The population consisted of Greeks and Romans and Jews. Now, when Jesus got out of the boat in the land of the Gerasenes, he met a wild man who was out of control. He could not be restrained. No shackle could bind him and no chain could hold him. Nobody could restrain him. He was violent and wild, and no one could tame him. We're told that he lived in the tombs. In those days, tombs were not holes dug up in the ground. They were like tiny caves hewn out of rock in hillsides. So this fellow lived in the tombs, which were tiny caves. The book of Numbers, chapter 19, verse 16, tells us that according to Jewish law, anyone who touched a grave was considered unclean for 7 days. So this fellow, if he was a Jew, was unclean because he lived in the tombs. He cut and mutilated himself by sharp stones. So he had bloody wrists and scratched skin. And whenever he was seen, he was naked. He was completely naked. This fellow was not born like this. He was not born with this condition. This wasn't something that he just came down with like the flu. At a certain time in his experience, this man, this Humpty Dumpty, made a conscious decision to reject God's influence and authority over his life. And so, he was possessed by evil spirits. The New Testament makes it clear that if our heart is vacant, if Jesus does not occupy our heart, the evil spirits will come and reside there. So, this fellow, by his own choice, became possessed by evil spirits who tormented him. And this fellow decided to disregard all the conventions of social life and all the responsibilities of citizenship. A recent survey done in America reveals that only 43% of Americans believe that there is a devil. Only 43% of Americans, that's less than half of the population of the country. In 1947, a reporter for Time magazine, during an interview with C.S. Lewis, who was the greatest theologian of the 20th century, was asked about his belief in the devil. And I like the way C.S. Lewis addressed the issue. He said, if by the devil you mean a self-existent being, then my answer is no. There is no uncreated being except God. Then he told the reporter that he should have asked the proper question, which was whether he believed in the devil, in devils. And he said, In that case, yes, I do believe in devils. And he went on to say that at a certain time, a group of angels abused their free will and decided to reject God's authority over them, rebelled against God, and chose to become enemies to God. And their leader was Satan. C.S. Lewis says there are two harmful errors. One is to disbelieve in the devil's existence. The other one is to acknowledge their existence, but to be excessively interested in them. So it's wrong to have an unhealthy and excessive interest in the devils. And C.S. Lewis says the devils love both errors. They enjoy both errors. The devils want you to believe that they don't exist, and the devils want you to have an unhealthy, excessive interest in them. Now this story, which is found in the Gospel of Luke chapter 8, starting with verse 26, going through verse 38, has a parallel account in the Gospel of Mark chapter 5. You can read the same story in the Gospel of Mark chapter 5. The first half of the chapter deals with this story. But there's a nuance which you don't find it in the Gospel of Luke. In the account we have in the Gospel of Mark, it says regarding this wild man, no one could bind him anymore. No one could bind him anymore. Which means there was a time when the people of the Gerasenes could subdue him. But with the passage of time, this fellow's condition became worse and nobody could subdue him anymore. Throughout Jesus' encounter with this wild, violent man, the disciples remained silent. They never said a thing. They must have watched this whole episode with open mouths and open eyes. Most probably they started running back to their boat because they were scared by this violent man. So this fellow was a Humpty Dumpty that Jesus healed and restored him to health and sanity. This insane man became sane. The violent man became gentle. He who roamed the countryside naked was now properly dressed. The man who was irresponsible became a responsible citizen. What a great transformation. But in Luke chapter 8, verse 35, we find something that amazes us. We find something that really shocks us. Luke chapter 8, verse 35 says, when the people found the man from whom the evil spirits had gone out, when they found him dressed and in the right mind, they were afraid and asked Jesus to leave their region. Isn't this interesting? They were not afraid of this violent man when he was insane, when he was violent, when he went around naked, but when they found him healed, when they found him in his right mind, properly dressed, completely transformed, they became afraid. And instead of expressing their gratitude to Jesus, they asked him to leave their region. They were afraid of the healed man, and they were afraid of Jesus' power. Now, in today's society, we find that people are frightened not by the unholy, but they are frightened by the holy. People today are not frightened by gun violence. They're not frightened by this, by pornography. They're not alarmed by human trafficking. They're not alarmed by the decline in morality. But they're frightened by allowing voluntary prayers in public schools. People are not afraid of the unholy, they are afraid of the holy. Like the people of the Gesserines. Those people were afraid of the wrong things and they felt comfortable with the wrong things. And today, people, unfortunately, have become comfortable with evil. William Bennett, who was the Secretary of Education in 1985, wrote a book entitled The Death of Outrage. The Death of Outrage. He says there was a time when society expressed its outrage whenever they saw human misconduct. But this outrage no longer exists. And he says, today we try to excuse criminal behavior. Instead of dealing with criminal behavior, we try to excuse it. This reminds me of a verse in Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 15. Jeremiah 6, 15. There the prophet describes his contemporaries. He describes the people who lived at his time. And he says, are they ashamed of their conduct? No. They were not ashamed at all. They even forgot how to blush. The community in the region of the Gesserines that lived with a crazy, violent, naked man could not tolerate Jesus. They could not tolerate Jesus' presence among them. They were afraid of him and they asked him to leave their land. In 1938, Britain and France signed what is known in history as the Munich Pact. According to this treaty, Britain and France agreed to Germany's takeover of Czechoslovakia as long as Hitler promised not to take over other territories in Europe. This policy became known as the policy of appeasement. It didn't work because after Czechoslovakia, after conquering Czechoslovakia, Hitler invaded Poland and other European countries. According to the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 6, we are engaged in a spiritual warfare. Whether we admit it or not, we are involved in a spiritual warfare. When he says our battle is not with flesh and blood, we're not fighting against human beings, but he says we are fighting with the powers of darkness, with the powers of evil. And in this spiritual warfare, appeasement and compromise don't work. We cannot accept the unacceptable. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, we, all of us, are like Humpty Dumpty. We're broken. We're broken because we tend to be selfish, living a self-centered life. We are impatient, we are stubborn, sometimes we are out of control. We have an unforgiving attitude to those who hurt us, and we don't love people unconditionally. So we are broken. We are like Humpty Dumpty. But Jesus is the only one who can take our shattered lives, take those pieces of our shattered lives, put them back together again. Jesus alone can restore us. Because in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, Jesus says, part of his mission to this world is to heal the brokenhearted and to bring deliverance to the captives. Jesus can deliver us from the dominion of sin, from the captivity of sin. Jesus can deliver us from the captivity of bad habits that we have formed. So Jesus can restore us fully if we only yield to his influence. And at this time, we'll sing a special song. In number 74, we'll sing the first three stanzas.